Professor Dave here. Let's revisit differentiation.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
When we first learned about differentiation, we saw it as a way to determine the rate of change for a curve given by some function f of x. When taking derivatives, the way we expressed the operation was by using this prime symbol. So the derivative of f of x was f prime of x. But there is another notation, which we have introduced in the past, that will now be used much more frequently. That looks like this, which is red d dx. This can be thought of as a differential operator that acts on whatever we put it in front of. So to take the derivative of f, we would put d dx in front of it, like so. This is also commonly written as df dx. Now, don't let the new notation confuse you. This is still the same as the derivative of some function f, which we previously called f prime. It's just a different way of representing differentiation that has a few benefits. For example, this differential operator distributes across sums and differences. So d dx of the sum of two functions, f and g, is the same as the sum of df dx and dg dx. Meanwhile, when operating on a product of functions, f times g, this will be the same as the product rule we learned previously. So d dx fg equals f dg dx plus df dx g. And similarly, the quotient rule still applies. So d dx f over g equals g df dx minus f dg dx over g squared. The reason we are reintroducing this notation now is because we will want to take more derivatives than just those that are with respect to the variable x. So we need some clear notation that indicates which variable we will be differentiating by. Now, let's say we have a function that depends on both x and y, which we can call f of xy. This will end up being a surface in space rather than a curve. So how can we interpret the rate of change for this? What we end up having to do is to find the rate of change in specific directions independently. If we want the rate of change in the x direction, much like we have been doing already, we simply differentiate with respect to x while treating y as a constant. The new notation for this involves using these curvy d's instead of regular ones, which gives us this. This is called a partial derivative, and it tells us to only treat x as the variable to differentiate. Similarly, if we wanted the rate of change in the y direction, this would be a partial derivative with respect to y. In this case, we would treat x as a constant. Let's consider an example. F of xy equals xy squared plus x cubed, and find the partial derivatives with respect to x and y. First, df dx. We will take the derivative with respect to x just like we are used to while treating y as a constant. Remembering our power rule for derivatives, the first term's x becomes 1, and treating the y squared as a constant, we are just left with y squared. Then for the second term, we bring down the 3 and reduce the power by 1, leaving us with 3x squared. So our partial derivative, df dx, becomes y squared plus 3x squared. Now to find the partial derivative with respect to y, we will treat y as our variable while treating x as a constant. The first term depends on y squared, so we bring down the 2 and reduce the power by 1, leaving us with 2y. But this is multiplied by x, which we treat as a constant, so we get 2xy. The second term does not depend on y, so this is just a constant, and the derivative of a constant is always zero. So we are left with 2xy for our partial derivative, df dy. These are the rates of change in the x and y directions for our function. We will now introduce a concept that combines these partial derivatives, and that is called the gradient. The gradient of a function is simply a vector made up of all its partial derivatives in their associated positions. This means the x direction for df dx, the y direction for df dy, and so on. We can write this out as grad f equals df dx I plus df dy j. If in three dimensions, that would be grad f equals df dx I plus df dy j plus df dz k. The components of this gradient vector are the partial derivatives of the function f, which we can produce in the manner we just discussed. This vector ends up being the closest thing to a slope that we can get in higher dimensions. It points in the direction of maximum change of the function and has a magnitude equal to the maximum rate of change. There's also another common way to write the gradient involving this upside-down triangle, which is referred to as del. This del is a vector of all the partial derivative operators. So in two dimensions, it is d dx, d dy. And in three dimensions, it is d dx, d dy, d dz. Writing del in front of a function f is the same as taking its gradient. Del has a variety of other uses that we will get into in another lesson, but for now, let's consider one more example of a function and find its gradient. Consider the function f of xyz equals x to the fifth e to the 2z over y. To find the gradient, we will need all the partial derivatives, df dx, df dy, and df dz. Starting with x and treating y and z as constants, following the power rule, we bring down the 5 and subtract 1 from the exponent, leaving us with 5x to the fourth, e to the 2z over y, for our partial derivative with respect to x. Now differentiating with respect to y and keeping x and z constant, 1 over y is the same as y to the negative 1. So again, using the power rule, we bring the negative 1 out front and subtract 1 from the exponent to get negative y to the negative 2, which is the same thing as negative 1 over y squared. Combining this with the constant terms, we get negative x to the fifth e to the 2z over y squared. Finally, we will take the derivative with respect to z while keeping x and y constant. We must differentiate e to the 2z, and following the chain rule, we simply keep the e to the 2z, but bring down the derivative of the exponent 2z, which is 2. This gives us 2e to the 2z, and putting it together with the constant terms, we get 2x to the fifth, e to the 2z, over y. We now have all three partial derivatives, so to get the gradient, we simply put them into the vector form of df dx, df dy, df dz. This gives us 5x to the fourth e to the 2z over y, negative x to the fifth e to the 2z over y squared, 2x to the fifth e to the 2z over y, as the gradient vector for this function. You may have noticed during this lesson that we have been using our variables x, y, and z inside of vectors. We'll be discussing this concept in depth when we discuss vector fields in a moment, and we will also be discussing more uses of del. But first, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.